Hello, hi. Hello, welcome to the ICA. I am Rosalie Dobell, one of the associate curators here. I am delighted to welcome Jan Verwoert, who stands next to me, from Berlin this morning, so thank you for making the journey. He will be returning to Oslo. Of course, we know Jan as a critic and writer and contributing editor of Freeze. He is also a professor for theory at the Oslo National Academy of Arts and a teacher at the Piet Zwart Institute in Rotterdam and the D'Apple Curatorial Programme. Jan was also previously an intern in the Talks Department at the ICA. He's authored... I think checking the answer machine, was it? Yeah. He's authored many books, and his second collection of essays, Cookie, is lurking in our bookshop. Tonight, he is here to talk to us about Seduction and Metabolism, which is the first in a series of talks here at the ICA called Artists, What is Your Value?, which will look at questions of the value of art and artists unfolding throughout this year. Please sign up to our newsletter to hear more. This was a series that's been conceived in collaboration with Andrea Phillips, who I'm sure many of you are aware is doing very important and interesting research about the question of value, and I'd like to thank her. We will be having questions at the end. Please wait for the microphone, but I will now hand over to Jan. Thank you.
Hey, thank you for the introduction, the invitation, and thank you for coming tonight. I really had decided not to talk about the internship, but since you mentioned it, one reason why I feel so massively indebted to the ICA is when I was studying here, God, 20 years ago in London, God, I felt, and that has a lot to do with metabolism. It was pretty much the first time that I experienced something like theory becoming part of an urban metabolism. In the sense that theory, I felt, as it was talked here or at the Slate, where Michael Newman was organizing talks, theory was not so much a language of legitimation, like a paternal voice of authority that you would appeal to, but it was really a way of feeding oneself with things that one would chew on without necessarily fully understanding, and that seemed to be the point. Which, contrary to my German education, was a completely new thing. It was finally not about people trying to be right about something, but about people throwing things at each other that they had half chewed on, Lacanian theory, post-colonial theory, and it was a kind of a strange feast of everybody cooking that stuff together. Oh, Lacan, the symbolic, the real, and the imaginary. Now here you have a go. And then someone else would try it and fail, and then it would kind of... circulate as a language, which I still aspire to as an ideal way of thinking in a city. Things may have changed, I don't know, but I found this massively inspiring and ended up trying to get close to it at the ICA, at the talks department, which at the time was before email. So the main means of communication was the answering machine. And my job as an intern was to listen to the messages of the answer machine and transcribe them, which is, was just a moment in the mid-90s when things were getting really kind of global, and the names that were on the answering machine, I tell you, were really difficult to... Hello, my name is... Please call me back very urgently. And then you can replay that message 30 times and you realize our names are really the most difficult things about us. thank God for email. okay, seduction value. Why would I want to talk about that in London? So it's a risk that I'm taking, and I'm massively depending on your patience, because I might only be telling you things that you know much better than I. Because I guess discussing the value of seduction in London is like, I don't know, debating coals in Newcastle. It's like what this city is built on, and what you basically have to know about, learn about, to be able to survive in a place like that. I mean, the last time I tried to talk about similar things in New York, I failed brutally, because I felt like, listen, I cannot tell you anything new. I can just read aloud from the menu that you find in front of yourself in the restaurant of your choice every day anyway. And that's what I will do, basically. I have a few points on the menu of seduction value that I want to run through. in preparing this talk, I also realized that I might be touching on a lot of things that I've been trying to address in previous talks. Some of them, I think, have found their way on the internet, so you might know some of the jokes that I'm presenting here as a mix down of best of with a lot of new material. But the reason for that being that I realized in the last couple of years strongly believe that if there's a politics to art, it is an immanent and inherent politics which has a lot about to do with how we go about negotiating, proposing, soliciting, eliciting a sense of value through our work. How do we approach the power of value systems that are already in place? Do we opt in? Do we opt out? Do we opt in only to trick them? There are ever so many moves that can be inherent to an art practice, to how you move close to a pre-existing dominant order of values, only to maybe ever so slightly move away from it. And I think this is what is inherent to artistic style, which makes it political on the level of a basic negotiation of how we performatively enter into the pre-existing economies of value. And economies of value production, which and that might be my mildly psychoanalytic bias. For me, is an economy that is very much also a economy of desire. So I guess what we are dabbling in, what we're dealing with in the arts, yes, is an economy of the production of value, an economy of the production of attention, but very much also an economy of the production of desirabilities. What's hot, what's not, what could we possibly want today? Who has it, who can tell us, who can give us the secret knowledge of what is currently desirable? And that is never just abstract business. It's never just an information that you receive on Art Daily or wherever what's currently desirable, because it's never just about things and images, it's about us. No, because fundamentally on the level on the market of desirabilities, hell yes, I want to be desirable, and I'm assuming you want that too. So it's not just objects that we're trading or artifacts, it's pretty much our own powers, potentials, potencies to give and to get. So that's what I'm insinuating is at stake in an economy of seduction and an economy of desire. It is very much that feeling of being able to give what could be recognized as desirable or to actually get it. That's why I would probably also rename it or subtitle the talk, The Value of What You Give and Get. There's three modalities of giving and getting that I want to talk about, and basically that's the structure of the talk. The three modes of seduction, the three modes of desire, the three modes of giving and getting. The first is the gift, the second is the delivery, and the third is the best. In terms of seduction, I would say, well, the gift is the first. I'm basically giving you all I'm giving you the basic argument so you know what I'm talking about, and then I will fill in the gaps. I'm giving away all the punchlines now in the beginning. The gift is fundamentally a form of the most profound seduction, namely self-seduction. The first seduction of artistic production, the first seduction of theory production, is to self-seduce oneself into the feeling that you would have something to give. Oh my God, I have an idea. I just had a 10-minute shower. I really feel this idea is fantastic. I have to tell people about it. So I seduced myself into feeling that I would have something to give to you tonight, yeah? Which is completely unwarranted, and it might be a complete self-deception, but we will see. So the gift starts with the sublime act of self-seduction, where you seduce yourself into feeling that you would have something to share with the world. And the delivery, on the one hand, could be a professionalized form of self-seduction. At some point, you get so good at convincing yourself that you would have something to share that you also pick up the required rhetorical skills to deliver things properly. But in a certain way, the delivery is always also a deliverance. At some point, when you're in the business of delivering desirabilities, you realize this won't work if I cannot seduce the audience into believing that they can give something back to me. A talk, an exhibition, a presentation will always fail if you just have someone naively giving, bombing the audience. The first law of refined seduction is, no, you have to deliver the audience from their feeling that they don't know what to do with themselves. No, the audience needs, you guys need to feel like you can actually now look back at me, talk back at me, feel back at me, think back at me. And if I don't succeed in delivering you from the big question, why the hell did we come tonight? This ship will sink in 5 minutes. Activating the audience, delivering the audience from the feeling that they don't know what the hell they're doing in this space, that is really the second law of survival. No? Seducing the audience into self-seducing themselves that they could now give something. So we have to turn the tables to be able to sustain seduction so that it becomes mutual seduction rather than pure self-seduction. And this is a game that we can play with a lot of pleasure for a long time. And at some point, I realized in the last couple of years, since we've become so professional at self-seducing ourselves and others, that there's a new language that we can hear, which is a language that's becoming more and more jaded. Like, we're in it, we know how to talk badly in a distanced way about being these agents selling and buying desirabilities. And secretly, we dream of, as a friend of mine once put it, of clawing ourselves into an untouchable place. As long as we still play the game of desirability and seduction, yes, hell, we remain touchable, and painfully so, with all the embarrassments associated with becoming touchable. The longer you play this game, the more you find yourself dreaming of that moment when you can claw yourself into an untouchable space where this back and forth of desire can no longer affect you, and that is the best. Yeah, the best is the untouchable place, the place beyond the back and forth of desire, the moment when you are finally on top of the world. Don't worry, I won't play any Titanic clips, yeah, but that's basically the feeling. That we could only escape, that apartment in Knightsbridge somewhere where you feel like, fuck, I don't have to be on the subway anymore. You know, I have the best, the fucking best. No, and you know, living in a city like this, you constantly feel it. You feel like, oh, there must be places where I will be exempt from the painful game, the back and forth of seduction and self-seduction, and that's the best. And I'll get to that in the end. If we find time, since I will be starting from a defense of the gift to a mildly cynical and then ever more cynical description of the delivery and the best, so I'm going to progressively start to become more and more depressing. Hopefully we'll have enough time to, in the end, somehow bring the boat back into the harbor, hopefully. We're saying, like, okay, if the best is the worst, then maybe I have one last seduction, one last proposition to make, which is maybe that rather than opting out, we might all want to think about rebooting our metabolism. But that's just a postscriptum. Let's start with the gift, the supreme act of self-seduction, to think, hell yes, I have something to give to you, which in itself would be a pretty profane act. And I mean, everybody has ideas, everybody has something to say. So how do you go about giving the gift when the gift is not just an object of trade, when the gift is also an object of seduction? Well, you wrap it. No, it's not just, hey, happy birthday, here's your new pair of socks or whatever what you wanted. No, you wrap it. Why do we wrap things? Because the gift in itself as an object of trade would not be enough. We have to somehow already on that level deliver ourselves from the profanity of the act of giving. And that's why we wrap things. No, we wrap them beautifully. We turn them into little secrets. I have something to give to you, but you don't know yet what it will be. I'm going to hide it until Christmas, and then maybe a day before you can look into the wardrobe. I'm going to develop an elaborate theory on what I'm going to give so that you don't understand right away that I will always talk about the same thing. No, it's going to be totally different this time. I'm going to use new concepts. I'm going to wrap it up nicely. I'm going to show you the box, but I won't let you know what's in it. When actually, of course, the profanity, and I've made that joke a million times before, I apologize, but of course the profanity of the gift will always shine through. No matter how elaborate we wrap it, to seduce ourselves into thinking that we would have something special to offer, we pretty much know what's in the box. Yeah? So, I mean, that's in one box, that's in the other box. No? It's Justin Timberlake on Saturday Night Live offering a dick in the box, and this was a viral video on YouTube offering a box in a box first. I mean, that's the thing with giving, the profanity of the act of giving. At the end of the day, what we give is ourselves. And hey, there's no surprise. No, I know what's in your box, you know what's in my box. On that level, the act of the gift is absolutely profane. And you could say, well, that's why we wrap our gifts in art and culture, so that for a moment we absolve ourselves from the understanding of how profane and without surprises the act of giving is, because I cannot only give you myself in the same way that you can only give me yourself. So we kind of, there would be no excitement if not, if we wouldn't put things in boxes. At the same time, there is a particular form of culture which somehow understands both. The profanity that we all know what's in the box, that the gift is never ever a surprise, on the one hand, and at the same time, wrapping the gift in the most colorful, in the most colorful wrappings. And that is actually the culture of carnival, which is so incredible because it acknowledges that, yes, hell, it's all about shaking the tree, you know? That is, I mean, what do you have to shake? What is your gift? What is my gift? There's only ever so many gifts, and the point is you translate that profanity into a relational object and an external object that allows you to do what you would otherwise do and not do it at the same time. So in that sense, the culture of carnival is totally honest about acknowledging that the logic of the gift is, and now I'm using American English that I am not fully competent of, is to shake what your mama gave you, basically. Yeah? So that acknowledgement is, yeah, shake it, baby, is basically, that's the gift giving in its profanity and without surprises. But in the moment that it becomes carnivalesque, it is that profanity celebrated as a mystery. And that's why I think a carnivalesque culture has so much going for it. It's probably the most honest culture about the economy of seduction that seduces or draws the very profanity of the unsurprising gift into an exuberant exchange where we shake what our mama gave us. Profoundly so. On that level, I could already stop and say, like, why are we having so little fun? I mean, I feel like in the more art has been professionalized in the last 10, 15 years, the more this carnivalesque spirit of celebrating the mystery of the profanity of our gifts has been beaten out of everyone. No, please don't do that shaking. Let's be a little bit more discreet. Don't talk about your mama. Like, really, this is too much information. This doesn't look good on the gallery. Press information. Please control yourself. Yeah, and we've seen this before. Please not again. Yeah. So on a certain level, I think if you look into what's being shown in many, many galleries around cities like London or New York, you constantly feel like, why so serious? It seems like we constantly have to remind ourselves that there is more to us, there's more to art, there must be more to thinking. We live in this incredibly expensive city, so it can't just be about that. No, it must be about something more than that. So at the end of the day, I don't think that we're having enough fun. Which is, in the end, I'm assuming, why we got into art in the first place and not straightforwardly into, I don't know, advertising. Or, I don't know, any other university discipline that has you writing long footnotes. So on a certain level, I would say what's urgently needed is maybe a return to the generosity of the self-seduction of the parade where... the audience, the performers, I don't know, seduce themselves mutually into, I don't know, shaking what their mama gave them. And where I feel like a certain naivety or exuberance that might be exactly what's beaten out of you in art school is maybe on a certain level something that is worth holding onto. And I have to say, from a white boy perspective, for me, my exuberance test, or the obscenity of the gift in its original selfishness and generosity. The text that I usually do is, if I can hum this melody to an artwork, and I usually tend to like it. For me, that's the sheer exuberance of feeling like, la 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 la, la, watch me now, la 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 la. It's like the absolute banality of a melody that suddenly sounds as fresh as only Depeche Mode could make it sound in that moment of exuberance. Hey, four notes. Wow, I just can't get enough, which also means I just can't give enough. The four notes, I'm giving them to you again and again and again and again. If there's anything I would hope for is that some of that spirit might eventually return into a very serious, professionalized desire economy. At the same time, okay, this is the positive start, now it starts getting depressing. Of course, you realize there is also a fundamental selfishness about giving. Thinking like, hey, I've got this great idea, I've got these four great notes, and you've never heard them before. Because in the end, the giver is never generous. That's an experience that you make when you start approaching audiences. The generosity is never on the giver's side, the generosity is on the side of the audience. No, the audience has to patiently bear with that person who's so full of their energy to give something that you have to generously bear with that moment of absolute delusion, if you will. So that's the first realization that many performers probably never make, that fundamentally they are dependent on the generosity of the audience entertaining the selfish giver. Sometimes it works well. You are happy, you find a generous audience who listens, participates, throws energy back at you. But then, of course, when you're selfishly giving, sooner or later, of course, you will find an audience that doesn't quite cooperate. And then you stand there and you see you have all these things to offer. And in the mirror, you just find, people are there, well, they're bored, it's a big city, they're already checking their emails, they're checking Facebook, oh my God, there was something else happening tonight, all the things that I'm missing, what is this guy going on about? You know, you can see here in Manet's final painting, the audience being professionally bored, waiting for something to happen. Okay, what's going to happen tonight? Tonight there's Mr. Greenfoot doing a performance. Oh God, we've seen Greenfoot before. Okay, maybe we should have gone to another place tonight. Terrible, no? And that's the moment when, of course, as a performer, you feel absolutely, totally alienated, because in those moments you realize that your delusion that you would have something to give is brutally shattered, and you realize that you are at the mercy of these people who have all the time in the world to decide whether they're going to be generous with you or not. No, because it depends on what you show them. Do you show them your feet? What's going to happen tonight? Let's see. the first realization that sometimes destroys, maybe forever, the naivety of the giving is to understand, no, you are fundamentally existentially dependent on the generosity of the audience to entertain, to indulge you. And if they don't, they won't. If they won't, they don't. That's usually the moment when you start becoming professional, when you realize, damn, I don't want to be at the mercy of the generosity of the audience. I have to get better at making the audience feel that they're being spoken to, that they're seeing something, that they're actually witnessing an event. And that's the main thing, I guess, right now in our attention economy, in our desire economy, is the production of events. No, like in the arts, yes, performances always bring in more people into the gallery. If you're a musician, it's even worse. No one will buy any records or CDs anymore. So basically, as a musician, you're back to the 1950s where you have to tour. You have to keep producing events that will draw in a crowd so that you can actually sustain your existence. So the understanding that you're at the mercy of the audience is part and parcel of a professionalized understanding of becoming an entertainer, a showman, an artist as showman. Yes, of course. And I've heard a lot of people in my professional surroundings saying things like, okay, he's a great artist, he delivers. It's like, what the hell are we delivering? What's the delivery? Well, are we talking pizza delivery? Are we the delivery boys and girls? No, actually, we deliver high performance. We're high performance deliverers. We're producing the value of the event, of something where you feel the electricity. Wow, I'm in the right place. I'm really in London. This is totally happening. This is high performance. I've seen these ads everywhere, and I still haven't understood what the hell this company is actually selling. I mean, someone once explained it to me. I cannot remember. Accenture, high performance delivered. They have these great ads. Like wet feet, what? High performance here, Guggenheim, okay. Or what is it, MoMA? No, I don't know, like some art shit, yeah. High performance delivered. Yeah. And then I find this curated with love, handled with care. Delivery, here you go. Love and care delivered in a box. That's what we wanted. No, that was a good Friday night.
tune in next week when our distinguished panel will discuss the burning question, what are we doing here?
Okay, that's you here. And at the end of the day, you realize we're not just delivering high performance. No, what we deliver ourselves from in the moment when we produce an event is exactly the burning question that Kermit the Frog addresses here. What the hell are we doing here? No, that's the main thing why you produce an event, if you will. And I realized that, I don't know, I was in a performance festival in New York where I suddenly realized, wait a second, everything about the event is curated with much more care than the actual performances. You know, from the way how the doorman looked to the way how the food was being offered, everything on this performance evening was geared towards making whoever paid the insane entrance fee feel that they actually were there for a good reason. Not just on that night in that place, but I don't know, this month in this city. No, because the burning question, what the hell are we doing here when we've got so many options? On the one hand, why the ICA tonight? I have to give you a good answer, otherwise you will feel really, really bad about tonight. But it's not just about being in one place at one time, it's also being in an insanely expensive city in the first place. No. Why would you want to live in New York in a shoebox for an insane rent if not if you could go to events that make you feel like you're in New York for a good reason because you can only get that shit in New York? Yeah. So you realize we're becoming more and more kind of the legitimators of an insane city economy by producing cultural resemblances of the value of that very city. No. Why being in London? Because you can see a talk or a show like this, and then everybody who's working on the side of putting that show together knows they have to make anybody who made the investment of coming and being in that place on in that week, in that month, feel like they have not been wasting their rent on something that is completely empty, when of course all we know that it might as well be. So in the end, I think an economy delivers all of us from the big question why we're in it in the first place. Now, why are we here tonight? Must be something about this city. No, what is it about this city? What is the value of this city? Well, it produces events like this, hopefully. Maybe not, if I fail. And I think this is something that Manet deeply knew, because he worked both the Muppet audience and the Muppet performance on the counter into one big painting that gives you the alienation of a strange turbulence, a strange moment of desirability generated in the space between the mirror and the body, where there is nothing, but in this nothing, something is being conjured up. A minor storm of desirability is cooked up that somehow validates maybe the fact that everybody's here, when everybody, as we've seen in the back, is of course asking themselves, where do I have it? Are we here for the right place? Are we here in the right place tonight? Should we have been going somewhere else? Is this only second best? Maybe we didn't get the ticket to the best. We don't know. And to absolve ourselves from that feeling, to make the audience feel at home in the place where they are, in the right place, I think is the essence of professional art practice, for better or worse. And I think if there's anybody who turned the tables in that way, it's probably Bob Morris. To understand it's not just enough to play the format of the gallery back into that format so that you have a mirror oscillation. You put a white cube into a white cube. Hey, it looks great, surprise. Yeah. But actually to also put mirrors on it so that the audience can see itself when it walks it in, and it feels absorbed from the question of what do I have to do with it? Yeah, no, of course you have something to do with it. You can see yourself in it. It's the mirror reflection that of one's own desire, that kind of strange point of light that makes you feel you have been seen. No, here there is it. Yes. This is Bob Morris. You came to the right place. Yeah. The light of your own desire for being an urban desirable citizen is reflected back on you, on your notes, in your face. This is how it works. Simple mirror trick. Mirroring this desire back to the audience, and they feel, and then you can even say, like, you know, I'm fucking with you. Hey, I said that, and it works. Yeah. You do it, and you admit it, and admitting it, strangely enough, doesn't disrupt the seduction. And that's the big Bob Morris move that I think today is still the blueprint for, I guess, a New York career, which is the double bluff. You fool people by giving them nothing but the reflection of their own desire, and you admit it on top of it by saying, you know, I'm just fucking with your desire. Here, I said it. And then the audience that's being deceived suddenly feels kind of included in their own deception. That's the trick. That's the double bluff. I fool you into giving you nothing but saying, like, exactly that's what you came for, didn't you? And the moment that you laugh, you feel like you're in on the joke that's actually on you. And I think that's the career double bluff that this guy pulled off, and it's still working. You say, what is a dollar bill? It's some strange piece of paper where somebody looks out at you from the middle. And that could be anyone. Anyone who knows how to play the game of saying, is that what you wanted? I know what you came here for. It's why I'm here too. And then you can play that game endlessly. It's a game of zeros. And it's a game of zeros consciously played that makes those who are in on the game, even if they're being fooled into just buying the own reflection of their desire, feel that they have a stake in the game. They're winning because they start to understand the rules even if they're losing. It's bizarre. And in the end, we end up with a flat tire. but maybe that's what we came here for. And as long as we feel that that's understood, we can all speak jadedly about the emptiness of the art world and all these things. And then we're still feeling that we're being deceived. Yeah, but we're still part of it, aren't we? No, the great mirror bluff. Is that the end point? That you enter, I learned this fantastic Yiddish term, which is Luftgeschäft, like air business. You're buying and selling hot air. And as long as you're consciously doing it, do you feel you're in on the economy? Is that the end point, that we all become progressively more jaded and knowing, and thereby certify that we still have a stake in the matter? I don't know, that's the moment when you start longing for the best, no? When you realize that this economy is running on empty. It's like conceptual dry heaving, and you feel like, someone beam me out, no? Into the best, the very best. And I don't know if you had that experience, like sometimes you get paid, sometimes you don't, and sometimes you don't get paid, but they book you into an insane hotel. I was on the Champs of fucking Lizzie in this thing that was just a Bob Morris mirror cube with kind of, I don't know, there were mirrors everywhere and flat screen TVs hidden in the mirrors, and like on either side of the room, so when you switched one off, the other would go on. It was crazy, and then all like Saudi Arabian music video clips on it that you couldn't sweat. Insane. And then you feel like, wow, I'm inside a Bob Morris mirror cube, maybe finally I'm safe. This is the best, the very best. No one can touch me in that mirror cube. I don't want anything anymore from anyone, and no one wants anything from me anymore. Like, I'm done for the day. That's the best. Yeah? That's the very, very best. Yeah? The best is the mixture between, I don't know, a jacuzzi and a bomb shelter. Yeah? You know, you're in the warm water, and the missiles will be protected by the Iron Dome. They won't get to you. It's a moment that I associate very much with the final scene in a fantastic movie, Plan Soleil, the talented Mr. Ripley, one of the first films on him, when Alain Delon as Ripley has cheated and murdered himself all the way through the economy of desire. He has moved from second best, being the second best, the surrogate guy, by killing the guy who was always in front of him. And now finally, he's got his name, he's got his money, he's got his wife, and then he realizes, oh my God, I've moved, I've fought so hard as a working class boy through this kind of economy of desire. I've come out on the other side. I'm finally safe. Of course he's not, but for a moment I feel safe, and that is the moment when I have the best. And there's this insane scene when he moves to the, comes to this cafe in Italy where they are, and I'm sorry, this is French and Italian with German subtitles, but he's going to the lady, and she says, you know, are you all right? And he says, yeah, I'm all right. What can I get you? And he just goes, the best. And I'm going to show it to you. No, that's the escape from the economy of desire. La meilleure, la meilleure, la meilleure. And then he gets it and he drinks it. This is so good, I have to show it to you again. And this is the feeling where people add more top floors to their apartments, buy half of the city, or I don't know, start a civil war somewhere, like just to get the feeling of like, I am on top of the world. I own this world. I have escaped into an untouchable place somewhere. La meilleure, la meilleure, la meilleure. What is our dream of the untouchable place? A detachable place where desire would no longer touch us. A friend from Miami recently sent me this, which is the fundamental untouchable place. You can order it here from a company in Britain. It's a certified zombie-proof shelter. It comes with different kind of, you can go from very good to the very best, and basically here at Extras buy, and it has a 30-year zombie-proof guarantee. It's unclear from whom you might want to claim that guarantee if the apocalypse hits, but here, this is the place of the very best, the place to which you escape to no longer be touched. No, it has everything, like to stay fit, it has the turntables, I think it even comes with a PlayStation, and a sustainable garden development and everything. Because you want to be free from those other fuckers who also want the best. Yeah? Everybody who runs around on the openings and who also wants that moment, who also wants that, you know, top floor flat in Knightsbridge where they give you, I don't know, warm towels and drinks, I don't know. I don't know what they do in Knightsbridge, but that's what we're dreaming of, no? But you suddenly realize that also from the zombie perspective, zombies, as zombies we know, if we can't get the best, but we still want to be desireless, if we can't get the top floor flat, what we need to do to feel desireless is to give up our metabolism. That's the sacrifice that we need to make. If we can't have the best, then we must give up our hunger and eat without being hungry. I mean, that's what makes zombies so popular at the moment. These are zombie crawls that are happening all over the States, where as kind of, I don't know, weekend entertainment, you can be a zombie on the street for a while and feel that you don't feel anymore. I mean, that's not even second best. That's almost as good as being in the jacuzzi bomb shelter on the top floor. It's like, I feel that I don't need, wait a second, I'm still unhappy when I feel that I don't feel. I don't feel that I don't feel anything anymore. This is better than Valium and whatever, ibuprofen on top. I am a zombie. I am no longer hungry. I have given up my metabolism. I eat without hunger. I eat without desire. That's, if I can't have the jacuzzi bomb shelter, then at least I will join the zombie crawl. Yeah, and the zombie crawl goes into all these spaces of desirelessness. If you go into you don't have to go to the zombie crawl, you can also go into the new Stedelijk. It's amazing. It's like so cleaned of every desire, it's impossible to find any trace of artistic metabolism in this new gallery. Yeah. Like, it's a complete zombified art space of total and utter bliss. I don't feel that I don't feel anything in there anymore. Yeah? So, and this could potentially be the best end by showing you the worst. To say, like, okay, for anyone who can't make it to the top floor bomb shelter, jacuzzi, underwater blowjob, whatever happens up there, like, there is still another option. Just give up your metabolism. And then you don't feel that you don't feel anymore. Like, there is a fundamental new culture of anesthetics. Sign up with the Stedelijk, you'll feel at home. Period. And this is usually where the theory ends. And I feel like there is a seduction within theory that, of course, you would want to give people the best. But since I can't give you a jacuzzi, I have to come up with something else. I have to promise you the worst. That's why currently I think a lot of theory is so apocalyptic, because theorists feel, since they cannot give you the best, they must make you feel as bad as they can possibly can. Like, so basically, usually the talk ends by saying, yeah, you know, we are all these agents of neoliberal desire production and it can't get any worse. And then everybody goes home and feels really, really bad and paranoid and feeling, I can't get the best, I must be a force of the worst. I'm a total neoliberal, effective, junkie, producer, jerk, and oh my God, is my dog already neoliberal or only my cat? Oh, this is just... So where depression is the alternative to acceleration. Acceleration for the after party and depression at the end of the theory, that you feel like, if I can't have the best, then at least I feel I can have a purchase on the worst. And I have to say, I despise that. even though like a lot of systematic theory would lead us to the conclusion that in a world where desire production is professionalized, the escape can only be to the best or the worst, so we have to think in luxury or apocalyptic terms. I don't feel that one should end on that note. I'm sure that the zombies are happy. I'm sure that to surrender one's metabolism is always an option. But I feel like leaving people with the worst because we cannot have the best is an unfair choice. Why go to these extremes when, as we've seen with the parade, with the carnival, the act of gift giving, the act of mutual self-seduction on a certain quite profane level should actually be possible. And that brings me to three more artists that I want to briefly talk about, three of my favorite artists, and I don't want to just bring them out as a deus ex machina at the end to promise you some deliverance, some salvation. I don't think that these are redemptive propositions. I don't think it is the task of art to redeem us from the kind of screwed up desire economies that we get ourselves into. But if redemption, salvation, deliverance is not our job, where else could a practice get some traction? And I believe it might be on the level of re-entering a metabolism into the act of gift giving and receiving. And I can't help thinking that an artist like Lydia Clark is absolutely super pivotal in that sense. Someone who's performative, conceptual, but actually at the same time also taking the challenge up, taking up the challenge of entering into a territory where you choose small audiences, which is maybe difficult to reconstruct because yes, now we get Lydia Clark from the internet and the history books, but as a choice that she made to start working with groups, to put her works to the test in something that might embarrassingly be called really a therapy session, but which is at the same time still some kind of artistic use of the means of seduction and production in these kind of exchanges that she was engendering. Here, this is people putting on masks that while being ghoulish and zombie-ish, are there to reactivate your metabolism, your senses. These gas masks that supposedly are about blocking you from the outside world are actually filled with kind of spices and herbs and things that, yeah, smell, that elicit sensual reactions, which I would say is like a collectively individualized or an individualized collective way of trying out how to start smelling and sensing again. And I know that I'm now starting to sound like a terrible hippie, but if you understand that as a political challenge, especially in times of military dictatorship in Brazil, then these psychedelic experiments may be small-scale attempts to reboot an autonomous metabolism of sensing, feeling, touching, somehow relating to something, establishing a grammar of relation through the body, through sensing, that is not yet on the basis of a tit for tat, a give and take, but a, eat, consume, smell, drool even. This is a performance she did, and I'm sure you've all seen these images. I only read about this recently, that it was actually that the performers had these strings in their mouth, so they were basically figuratively drooling on the body in the middle, like letting the spit drop from the mouth, connecting to spit. And this is not a zombie that eats without a metabolism, without hunger. These are cannibals who eat the flesh of their own community. They drool on each other, but they have a very lively metabolism, to the point of becoming, the excrement, the drool, the spit, becoming that which connects An artist that I love bringing up in this context, in of orality, of connecting to the mouth, and the mouth that has a metabolism not just of chewing and swallowing, but of chewing and spitting out again, is the Polish artist Alina Szapocznikov, for years now one of my main witnesses, who wrote a beautiful poem in the 60s, like a manifesto of sculptural practice, where she says, in doing sculpture is like chewing gum, where you take the world into the mouth and chew it and then spit it out again. This is what it means to do sculpture. It's like a oral metabolistic action, if you will. And I think, again, to bring it back to the parade, it does actually have a lot to do with the joys of carnival. Bakhtin, in his book about Rabelais, writes that the carnivalesque, grotesque spirit has a lot to do with the exaggeration of what happens around the orifices, the mouth, the oral. Here, this is a gargantua, a giant that offers you his mouth so you can jump in and be eaten as a carnival joy. In the same way that Szapocznikov was twisting the metabolism and offering mouth to eat. No, it's the next best thing to offering, to shaking what your mama gave you. It's, I don't know, giving your mouth away. Yeah. A deeply carnivalesque, grotesque action that allows for the body to come apart, to fall into pieces, but fundamentally in some kind of cyclical process of, you are not just becoming touchable, you're becoming edible. You're offering bits and pieces of you to become eaten, to become part of a kind of communal metabolism. I give you my mouth so you can eat it. Yeah. These are fantastic multiples by Alina Szapocznikov, who was then also doing mouth as table lamp. So everybody have a bit of mouth, everybody get mouthy. Everybody have a good mouth shine on them when they write or read. So like the mouth is spreading out and draws other activities in its metabolism. Anything that happens in the light of this lamp is part of the mouthy practice of Szapocznikov, which then extended also to these table lamps, shown that one time to many that work, one of my favorite pieces of art. It's actually a table lamp. There's a light bulb hidden in this banana penis nipple lip breast thing. A way of spreading bodies in pieces that kind of come apart in these metabolisms, but also recombine in strange way. These are fantastic fruit beds. And we come back to the shaking of the tree that I showed in the beginning. The lady is shaking the tree here, as you can see. This is actually from a fresco in the north of Italy. It actually exists. This is the tree of life. So the source of the ecology of birth and death, and it has a lot of penises, or let's say folly, growing in the trees. And as you can see, them all these ladies of the community are shaking the tree, which relates to a commonly held belief in the Middle Ages that witches would actually steal men's penises and hide them in birds' nests. So here we have one gathering them. Apart from bringing us back to the joyful obscenity of the carnivalesque, what I love about these thoughts that Lydia Clark and Szapocznikov seem to insinuate is that when we think of our metabolism as a potentially communal affair that takes us beyond an economy of desire, but not beyond the economy of desire just in terms of an escape, but in terms of an entry into the strange business of eating and being eaten, we might consider our bodies not just as property, as asset, as capital, but as these kind of strange communal resources. There are some passages in early Marx writing when Marx talks about the deprivatization of the senses, when he says, you know, we will only be able to leave capitalism behind when we don't even consider our senses private property anymore. And he actually says our senses will only become theoreticians if we if we allow them to become deprivatized. And I somehow can't help thinking that in these kind of metabolistic fantasies, there is definitely a deprivatization of the senses, a deprivatization of the organs, a strange disowning of the body parts of procreation and recreation. The phallus at some point no longer actually becomes a body part that is associated with any particular gender. It is just simply a means for carnivalesque performance. No, everybody can get one, and if you feel the itch, you scratch it. So in the sense that the body splits itself off, and what results from it is not an artifact that is passed back and forth in the economy of desire. I cannot desire to shake. I cannot desire to scratch. I either do it or I don't. And on that level, if you accept that as a proposition, I believe there could be another path into the communal life, not in the sign of desire, but in the sign of scratching, shaking, allowing for body parts to become these strange media of a communal metabolism of which we don't quite know yet what forms of life it might actually generate. This is work by by someone who studied with Alina Shapotsnikov called Maria Bartushova. She was studying with Shapotsnikov in Prague, where I find also work from the 60s, three more slides I want to show you, where I find this idea of a strange metabolism formulated in a truly radical form, because we don't even know what kind of creatures we're seeing here. It's as strange as some seashells might be, where you don't know, is this a stone? Is this a living organism? What the hell is going on here? So if I can have one postscriptum proposition, I would kind of take the way through Lydia Clark and Shapotsnikov to Maria Bartushova and suggest that in the moment when we might get fed up with the economy of desire, rather than dreaming of the best, I would suggest to rewind to the beginning, to the fun profanity of the gift wrapped in the carnival spectacle, and see in that carnivalesque gift not just an object of desire, but really a body part, an organ that becomes a means for a potential communal metabolism that could lead to a different ecology than the one that we know, where the artwork plays its own role, which is like actually the next best thing to an object like this, in facilitating that possibility of regaining a strange, new, and different metabolism. That was very esoteric, but I think I'm gonna stop here and thank you for your attention.
Hello, hi. I think we can have some questions now if we have for Jan. I wanted to ask you a little bit about how the role of contemporary criticism, so criticism that is now in the mainstream, sort of fits with this, whether it's shaking the tree, rebooting metabolism, has it got the ability to?
You're playing it back to me. That's a good question. No, on the one hand, I mean, like the obviously, I'm also paraphrasing what I do anyway, or what I hope to be doing, or what I somehow aspire to. No, on the one hand, you realize, yes, of course, I'm totally like an agent on the marketplace of producing desirabilities. That's I'm totally locked into a symbolic economy where I render things desirable, and I get part of the symbolic share. My name becomes desirable as I render other names desirable, and of course you can run the arithmetics on that. In a paranoid mood, that's what it boils down to. Know, that you become a slave as a critic to the same symbolic economy, and then you might be getting more paranoid than. A friend of mine once remarked that the reason why critics and curators can sometimes even become more paranoid than artists is because we constantly switch sides. You know? On the one hand, supposedly you are in the role of the person who assigns the mark of desirability to someone, but at the next moment, of course, you're also queuing up for the next gig. And how schizophrenic is that? And I'm not advocating a complete, that's why I'm trying to say, like, the point is maybe not a total escape, because that is a strange fantasy of how do you say that, when you eject from something that of course you know that you're totally and utterly part of. That's why I would rather than preach an escape, I would try to rewind and say, at the risk of naivety and childishness and the eagerness and idiotic ways of believing that one has terrorizing an audience by saying, oh, I have something to give, I think that is something that I would like to rewind to and say I'd rather really run for the ideas, and I appreciate people who take that risk of being caught in the naive position and going like, yay. That is something that, in case of doubt, I would defend on the one hand. And then how to turn writing into metabolism. Of course, I eat artists. That's what I feed on as a writer. I eat other people's practice. I write about other artists, and hopefully, as a teacher, I also eat. What do you guys think? There is a strange metabolism in, let's say, a studio visit or a tutorial, where I think it only works when you render yourself mutually edible, and that's called trust. And on the one hand, you know that as a teacher or writer, you can be called a cannibal. Because you feed on the energies that other people give to you, and that can be a horrible feeling. I mean, like, you write about an artist who's, I don't know, maybe worked 10 years, 20 years, 30 years on the work, and you have 1 week to write an article. Are you serious? Yeah. Can you eat a whole person in a week? That's absolutely fucking irresponsible. Yeah. But at the same time, to say, like, there is this kind of strange moment when you eat someone else, in that moment, when you write a text that is carefully written, it is also about kind of becoming edible in return. And when you realize there is text that are either readable or not so readable. And I think as a writer, there's a responsibility in struggling hard in becoming edible as you eat the artist you. And hopefully in this kind of strange mixture of writing a readable text about something that you've just ingested, you put it out there again, so to for someone else to eat it. I'm getting hungry as I'm talking about it. I think if there's an ethics of criticism, I would. There is like upfront cannibalism, absolutely. But it's like, what do you put, like the Chapotnikov chewing gum? What do you put out there, and how edible do you render it? Something like that. Of course, it can fail in an instant, completely.
Perhaps if we have no more questions, we could reconvene.
Guys,
in the bar.
Oh,
right at the back. Yeah. Excellent.
Hello. I guess I'm just going to form a question as I speak. I hope is that okay.
Yep.
But I was really curious about this kind of transition between the gift, the delivery, and that idea of the best. Mm-hmm. At some point, it seemed like you were referring not just to the artist, but to something that is out there somehow, mm-hmm. the art world.
Yeah.
And I feel like we're all embedded in this sort of first transaction, what we give, is not only the way you put it, like there is a generosity, mm-hmm. but I think there is something, an exchange, which is not only the idea of the gift, but the idea of the gifted, mm-hmm. the person that is gifted. So we're always kind of performing yeah. the critic, yeah, yeah, the collector, yeah. the blah, blah. And then that idea of delivery. So again, in the art world, I guess the question would be, I feel like there is this vicious tendency right now where we're all agents that are performing and clashing. How do you see not just the artist, but the collector and curator in this sort of scheme, the performers of another transaction?
Mm-hmm. No, I think what you were saying in the beginning was quite crucial to say, like, the strange thing, the more attuned you become to the entire economy of desire that you buy into, the more you realize that it's not necessarily your gift or your giftedness, but it is that strange thing that is somewhere out there that you kind of appeal to and that you somehow seek to embody, which is a feeling of desirability or the desire of of whatever renders the city desirable, whatever it is at the moment. And I think this kind of flickering, this of the air, this kind of strange movement where you feel like, oh, it might be this, it might be that. And I guess looking for that secret of desirability, which might be out there somewhere, is what brings everyone together. Like, as a critic, I might be chasing it as much as an artist or as a collector. And then you offer a work, you offer your body as a possible host to that spirit. So like, okay, the it thing is somewhere out there. Could I be it? So to be it, I have to offer my body so that it gets into me and I can reflect everyone's desire to see that it. It's a strange kind of collective voodoo dance around some spirit that's out there that would deliver us all from the question, what are we doing here? And even though that sounds cynical, I don't mean it in a completely cynical way, because the secret, it can be a very joyful game to play, to say like, okay, what is the city feeling today? How could I embody what the city is feeling today? I mean, so many great songs written, so many great pieces kind of capturing a spirit of a moment by offering a body and or an artifact or something to host that spirit. Of the moment, I'm sure it's not entirely impossible. And I think, I mean, the moment that you walk out from a great concert and you feel like, wow, that could have only happened in this place. I mean, that feeling, I'm not saying it's a delusion, because there is something in that collective air, in that atmosphere that you might wanna channel. So in that moment, this deliverance, the deliverance that the spirit comes and you feel like, wow, that was really it. I'm not saying that that's a delusion. And in that sense, I would see all of us trying to somehow channel this thing. But all I'm trying to think about is like how to think through it. Is that, what is the best way to think about this reaching out bit? Is it in terms of an immaterial channeling of the desirable, the hot, the it, or could it also be rethought on the level of something more imminent, that which is collectively somehow there, which moves, which this kind of morphogenetic field that sets a city in motion, why would we think about it on the level of symbolic representations of desires and certain spectacular embodiments in the form of events, when maybe one could also think about that which is in motion and moves on the level of a metabolism of what's being eaten somehow. That's the proposition. It's a collective game. The question is just, is it on the level of the big event, this symbolic elicitation of desirability, or could we think about it on a more edible, environmental level that would maybe also involve a bit more fun for everyone, so that kind of thing.
With the idea that we you like the guest, the gift, the deliverance, and the best, when looking at participatory art, and with the idea that what you were speaking about, Marx, and what I was saying about losing, making our senses common in order to appreciate and approach a piece of art. How can we analyze participatory art when this is about losing, like not having one spectator, but having a shared emotion, and when those events are also following the same idea that you have given tonight about and being used by the government as being more social and being, rather than artistic, trying to change a situation when not changing anything. Like, how can we analyze participatory art in that sense?
Yeah, super good question. I really don't know. The only thing that I can say, and I could go into it from another angle, is to think about it in a way that is not redemptive. I think that's usually the death of thinking about participatory art. Is, and I have the tendency to also do that, and that's when I become unbearable. When you think about participation as redemption, something to redeem the social, something to redeem the artwork, something to redeem ourselves from thinking, why the hell are we doing this? Oh yes, because I just made somebody happy. I think that's the road to hell, to think in too redemptive terms, and I don't know whether I've succeeded to avoid that in the end. I'm just thinking the attempt to talk about this work in terms of metabolism is also to bring a little bit of the brutality and maybe the awkwardness into this participatory thing, like the Lydia Clark thing of drooling on somebody. I don't think that is a redemptively participatory experience in the same way that, I don't know, like the violence of the mouse that eats and spits out, or the mouse that offers itself to be eaten. This is quite cruel, cannibalistic stuff. So on that level, if you would follow that through, also into a more post-human level, I think one thought I could only add is to, maybe that's a way to steer the participatory out of the redemptive. And also what I like, I have to say, like a second point about Lydia Clark is that I don't think that Lydia Clark is necessarily celebrating togetherness. There is something in this kind of, it's not a community that celebrates itself in terms of, oh, hey, great that we got together, but these works are isolating as much as they're bringing people together. They're bringing people together in their isolation. And they're also kind of shifting ideas of what is healing, I guess. Now, usually, I think in participation, the redemptive thing comes in when you think, oh, let's heal each other, let's get together. Well, I think in Lydia Clark, it's so much more subtle in the way how isolation and communality are brought together, are enacted through the artwork, where the work itself isolates and connects. And I find that very strong. And one would go much more into detail. But I'm just thinking, like, to participatory art as redemption, deliverance, no. As another form of metabolism, maybe yes, but a metabolism, it's not changing the social, it's getting away from a zombie nation that happily doesn't feel that it doesn't feel, back to starting from, okay, what is feeling in the first place? And I think it's super, super simple, super profane, and but I think it's a crucial step. It's no answer on the big picture level. No redemptive answer, but maybe downscaling to the moment where you get a metabolism back into your body, which I find fundamental. Yeah.
I think maybe just one last question.
Thank you. When you were talking about the best, it made me think of an article that I think might be relevant to it. It was an article I read in some kind of psychology magazine, and I'm going to try and paraphrase it, but it said that when you're the article was about how we behave with internet searches, and when apparently our brain releases endorphins or this happiness when we're looking for something and not when we arrive to it, which I thought was the opposite. I thought that whenever we got what we wanted, we had this kind of surge of happiness. And but apparently it happens when we're searching, which is why we continue searching, even though when we find our answer. So it made me think, when you were talking about the best being like that moment, when does it stop being the best? And because I have a feeling that it does, and then...
It totally does. Right. I mean, like, the best, eventually it will throw you back. And where's the best? Let me give you the best. you know that it's gonna be back into metabolism territory and desire production in 1 minute, because while this is happening, the police actually finds the body of the guy that he murdered. So 5 minutes later, he's under arrest. But I can't help thinking there is this difference between just money and this thing of the super rich, where a lot of like art production, I know when you go through Art Basel, where you find this is work produced for the super rich, who want to be protected from this relapse into desire. And how do you protect yourself? How do you keep yourself in this bubble of the best? I once had this experience of being driven to a house of a collector in one of the richest peoples in Mexico, I think. And when I was sitting in this car after we had some kind of critical discussion event, and I was really hungry and like grumpy, and I was sitting in the car, and I realized I had stared at the window, the side window of the car, for 5 minutes before realizing that I hadn't known how thick bulletproof glass is. It's like that thick, like a finger thick. And it feels like, wow, this is the best. and it is the best is staring at bulletproof glass. But it lasts, as you were saying, it only lasts for 3 minutes. It's like, wow. I've made it into a bulletproof car, until you feel like, oh fuck, maybe I should really be worried. Maybe there's reasons why this car needs to be bulletproof, and then, of course, it's gone again. And I have to say, like, there is, in terms of very spot on comments on this, the best, the best, the very best. I have to say, I have a certain respect for some of Monica Bonvincini's pieces, who, I think, in a very canny way, I think she plays that desire back to people. Like, there's a lot of works with bulletproof glass, haha. But where I feel like she got that thing, and she plays it back laughing. But you're right. It's only ever such a small bubble. But I think like there is in the current world, and that's the perversity. You know, the more like the large 90% of the population is pushed back into the wars of desire, the more on the level of the top 9-10%, you realize there's the cultivation of that jacuzzi bunker. No, and there's a lot of art production that is the interior decoration of the jacuzzi bunker that is there to prolong the feeling that you're on the level of the best, the very best. Yeah? And I don't even know how to relate to it. Honestly don't. If not as a fantasy of escape, well, of course I would like to have that drink. At the same time, I feel like, yeah, if it comes at the price of a loss of metabolism, where the zombie and the bunker jacuzzi dweller are basically actually interchangeable, because they've escaped from their own metabolism. I feel hell. Yeah, let's go back. Let's go back to the start and have a drink. Thanks for your patience.